Rory, as countries around the world, namely the US, Canada, and the UK, impose a ban on Russian oil imports, give us an idea of global supply once you've taken out those millions of barrels of Russian oil. And I guess, consequently, what does that do to costs?
Yeah, so just to put in perspective for a second, last year in 2021, the oil market spent the entirety of the year undersupplied by about 1.5 to 2 million barrels a day of crude oil, which is about 2% of global supply. And that deficit already brought us from, you know, $30 or below $30 in 2020, all the way up to $90 Brent before Russia and Ukraine even entered the headlines. So that kind of deficit was already there, bullish and kind of tight market fundamentals. Even if we lose 40% of Russian crude exports, Russia, you know, exports about 5 million barrels a day, that 40% loss, let's say if Europe stopped importing, would effectively double the deficit that we experienced last year. So, you know, obviously extremely, extremely tight, and prices are reflecting that. To put in perspective some of those crude export bans or oil export bans more broadly that we've seen announced from the US, Canada, and the UK now, all of those countries are relatively small importers of Russian kind of petroleum. But, you know, that's, you know, the first couple steps towards a broader prohibition or ban on Russian oil imports that had, or energy broadly, that had even a couple of weeks ago seemed like a fairly sacrosanct red line that people didn't want to go down because they were worried about the price spikes we're seeing right now. The challenge as well is that, you know, there's this open question of, do the bans matter? Because even before the, you know, the crude and the petroleum imports were officially banned and sanctioned, you already saw country, you know, companies across the West, you know, refusing to take Russian oil for fear of legal headaches and PR blowups. I mean, the most notable case of this was Shell bought a shipment of Russian oil, you know, a couple of days ago, and, you know, and I think they were right. They said that they justified the purchase by saying that the administration and governments have explicitly carved out Russian energy from the sanctions protocols because they didn't want to starve the market. But it didn't matter. The public blowback was immense, and within a couple of days, they were forced to basically issue a full walk back apology and say that they're never going to buy Russian oil again as long as this is going on. So I think this self-sanctioning is adding this element of additional strain on the market, and I think that's actually the main thing, rather than the explicit bans from Ottawa and Washington that are currently depriving the market of supply and tightening those balances.
Give us an idea of what futures contracts look like. Are you seeing, I guess, a hoarding or a stocking up of energy of these oil supplies?
I mean, the oil futures curve is deeply, deeply backwardated, which means that there's a strong premium for supplies right now. And if you look further down the curve, that quickly falls off. But I think it's important to note that the oil futures curve shouldn't be interpreted as a forecast per se. It should be, it reflects current dynamics, and the current dynamics are showing that we are desperately, desperately short of crude oil now. And that signal is effectively telling the market, empty all the inventories you can spare because we need them right now. Don't save them anymore. So I think what you're actually seeing is the opposite of hoarding. You're seeing an attempt by the market to press every possible barrel out of every possible tank farm in the world into the market to fill this gap.
Let's just talk about some of the big energy players that could step in to fill that gap. Give us an idea of where Saudi Arabia and UAE stand in this.
You know, in normal kind of crisis period like this, we would look to OPEC or now OPEC Plus to kind of provide emergency supplies to the market. Obviously, the challenge this year, and part of what brought us to those high $90 prices even before Russia and Ukraine entered the headlines, was that OPEC Plus was chronically falling behind on its supply addition. So there's already worry about kind of additional OPEC capacity. But I would say that the only two countries within OPEC Plus deal right now that have material amounts of spare capacity that could come on quickly and fill the gap would be Saudi Arabia and the UAE. And they probably have something in the ballpark of 2 to 3 million barrels a day between them, which may offset, you know, part of Russia's losses, but definitely couldn't offset a complete loss of exports. And there's this open question of, you know, after that, after those countries step in to fill the gap, you know, we have lost effectively our buffer. So it's an open question whether or not financial markets would actually find that calming at all. The physical market could be settled a little bit by those barrels, but the financial markets could actually go into an even bigger panic for worry that we would literally be out of that spare capacity cushion, which we've depended on for decades and decades.
How do Venezuela and Iran factor into this picture?
Yeah, so I mean, one of the interesting things is that the Biden administration has essentially been going, you know, full to the bat, trying to figure out how they can ease pressure in the global oil market, which it's difficult for them to do because they don't control production. You know, it's not a national oil company in the U.S. shale patch. It's a bunch of private producers. So they can't control that aspect directly. What they can control is potentially trying to ease restrictions or kind of sanctions on producers that are currently producing less than they otherwise would because of U.S. policy. And, this is mainly Iran and Venezuela. In Iran, it seems like, you know, things have progressed very, very quickly there. And I think no one's under the no one believes that it would have happened as quickly had it not been for this wildly high price spike. So I think, you know, you're definitely seeing the price pressure push the administration down that sanctions line quicker, the alleviation of the sanction line quicker rather. And Iran can probably add about 1 million barrels a day, give or take, to the market within 3 to 6 months. Venezuela, it's less and would probably take more time because Venezuela, even before the sanctions, was undergoing chronic supply losses due to, you know, tragic and chronic underinvestment in the sector. But you could probably see something in the ballpark of 500,000 barrels a day from Venezuela in 3 to 6 months if sanctions were removed today. So right there, we're talking about 1.5 million barrels a day, which, you know, combined with everything else, could start to help. But then we're back in the situation of, you know, where's the buffer and where is the next amount of oil going to be coming from? We need additional kind of oil from organic non-OPEC producers like the United States shale patch, like the Canadian oil sands. And I think that's the area that we need to see these price incentives start to kind of push these producers into producing more again.
I just want to pick up on what you had suggested there. You started off the conversation that U.S. Imports a small percentage of Russian oil, coal, and natural gas. But give us an idea now that part of the equation is missing for the U.S. How fast can they replace those supplies, and where do you see it coming from? I mean, you've mentioned the shale patch a few times now.
Yeah, so I mean, in terms of offsetting those Russian barrels, the shale patch is not a great fit because it's a very, very different type and quality of oil. So U.S. shale producers produce a very, very light grade, and a lot of what they're getting from Russia is actually what's known as these unfinished oils, which I've heard generally described in industry as Russian sludge. So it's very, very low quality, very, very heavy. What you can actually see there, and we've already seen it in some of the spreads and differentials, is you are seeing a very, very high bid for Western Canadian select barrels, particularly around the US Gulf Coast. And I think what you could see is that quality differential, again, that kind of aspect of the WCS discount that reflects the lower quality, the higher sulfur, the kind of heavier aspect. I think that's being quickly erased right now. So that is actually a benefit to Canadian producers. On the US side, while it's not a perfect kind of supplement or offset for Russian imports, the US will need to be a substantial portion of incremental supply growth in the global market because they're the ones that traditionally can grow the fastest. And what we've seen so far is they just have not yet been willing or able, it's an open question, to increase production more quickly. On the willing side, there's this narrative and concern about cash flow discipline that after a decade plus of overinvesting in the shale patch, of chasing every price rally higher and crushing prices repeatedly over the past decade. It's how we really got, you know, post 2014 crisis through to COVID. They destroyed hundreds of billions of dollars of investor capital, and investors are kind of, I think, reasonably wary that if you started, you know, growing gangbusters again in the U.S. shale patch, that you would just go into the same system and kind of crush any potential returns they'd see right now. On the able side of the equation, there's also this, you know, very, very tricky aspect of supply chain bottlenecks throughout the entire shale patch. We're talking, you know, an inability to source things like steel pipe, like sand that's used in fracking operations for proppant, and labor. I've heard stories about just, you know, really, really challenging issues trying to get people into these kind of industries right now, both because so many people left over the past decade, and because a lot of this work isn't always full-time. It can be contract. So a lot of people, you know, the labor supply is also very, very tight right now. And across the board, I think that combination is making it very, very difficult for the U.S. shale patch to grow, despite prices, you know, where they are right now at about $120, $130 a barrel.
Rory, can we expect to see more oil price shock?
I mean, it's obviously the trillion-dollar question. I think the challenge right now is that the data is so opaque, and that, you know, it's a deep fog of war, very literally, over the oil market. We don't know how far and how long Putin plans on going in Ukraine. We don't know the extent of all of the rest of the countries of the world, you know, Europe, and then potentially even, you know, US and NATO allies in Asia, how they will potentially kind of step in and also sanction Russian energy exports, which would further inflame the issue. There's also this question of, you know, how long will this go on? We don't know what Russia is exporting right now. We don't know what Russia will be exporting in 6 months. And we don't know what they will be producing overall in 2 years' time. We don't know whether or not this is something that Russia will just go back to normal after all this is done, or will they become a kind of an international chronic pariah state like we've seen from Iran, from Venezuela, where you've had, you know, an extended period of time, upwards of a decade of you know, underproduction because of sanctions, because of an exclusion from the international system. If it's the latter case, we are likely, you know, bound for a, you know, prolonged period of higher prices, because those prices will need to incentivize particularly non-OPEC production investment to fill that gap in the meantime.